إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, today is the first day of the Hajj. Today the people from around the world have gathered together for the largest annual religious gathering that humanity knows. And it is the gathering that takes place in the holy city of Mecca and the surrounding areas of Mecca. And these days and the rites of Hajj, every single rite of Hajj commemorates something from the great Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam. The great patriarch of all of the Abrahamic religions, the Prophet Ibrahim. That great prophet, that when a person came to our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he addressed him by the title, O best of mankind, our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his modesty, he said, no, that is not me. That is Ibrahim alaihi salam. O best of mankind, that is not me. That is Abraham. The great patriarch, the great prophet, the single most respected human being on the face of this earth. Because every single major religion of earth looks up to the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam. The Jewish, Christian and Muslim tradition are called Abrahamic traditions because they look up to the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam. And in fact, it is even said that the Hindus, the belief of Ibrahim reached them and they venerated it, and that is why the main god of Hinduism is called Brahman from Ibrahim. And this is a common theory that is well known, that the religion of Ibrahim even reached them and then they took it and they went into a different tangent. But the greatest venerated human being in the history of this world has been the Prophet Ibrahim. And our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as well praised him. And the Quran mentions him in more than 70 verses. More than 70 verses. And in fact, he is the only person that the Quran commands our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to look up to for guidance. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي إِبْرَاهِيمَ You have an Ibrahim and Uswatun Hasana. Look up to Ibrahim for a role model. Our Prophet is told to look up to him as a role model. And therefore, in these days, when the rites of Hajj, the pilgrimage, are taking place, each and every rite of which commemorates our father Ibrahim, let us look at some of the lessons we can glean from the life of this great Prophet of Allah Azza wa Jal. The Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam was born at a time when there were no believers in Allah. There were no true believers on earth. Idolatry had spread across all of humanity. And at a young age, he was guided to monotheism. And he knew that idol worship, that venerating the stars, that worshipping the sun and moon were false. And so he began to proclaim the message of La ilaha illallah, the message of monotheism, as a young teenager. When everyone in his society worshipped idols. And he challenged his own father in the most polite of manners, as the Quran tells us. Ya Abati, oh my dear father, how can you worship this idol? Oh my dear father, why would you worship that which can neither hear nor see? Oh my dear father, this is a rock and a stone. It cannot benefit you and harm you. Why do you not turn to the Creator of all? And he advises him and admonishes him in the most gentle of manners. And when that fails, he turns to his society at large. And he begins to preach to his society, first using the most wisest of manners and the gentlest of manners, by claiming that the sun and the moon and the stars are his creators, and he knew they were not the creators. But to test them and to show them how ridiculous it is to worship these celestial objects. And one by one he proves to them, the sun cannot be my creator, the moon cannot be my creator, the stars cannot be my creator, rather the creator of these must also be my creator, and that is the creator I will worship. And so he debates with his people and stands up for the truth, even though he was all alone in his society. And so we learn from the lessons of Ibrahim, we learn the importance of bravery, the importance of commitment, the importance of standing up for truth and justice, even if your whole society has rejected it. Ibrahim single-handedly stood up and preached the truth. And imagine in our times, when it is difficult even for a minority to preach the truth, imagine when it is but one person to stand up and challenge an entire community. Ibrahim knew that Allah was on his side, and that's all he needed to know. And therefore, when the people of his community began to persecute him, when they began to torture him, when they built that fire that they built, the Nimrud, the fire of Nimrud, and they told him to recant or else we will throw you into the fire, he said, I cannot give up the truth. I cannot budge from this position because I know it to be true. And there was not one supporter that he had. Even his father remained an idol worshipper. Even his father sided with Nimrud against his own son. And therefore, when he put his trust in Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showed him the results of that. And when he was thrown into the fire, Allah says in the Quran, we told the fire, قُلْنَا يَا نَارُ كُونِي بَرْدًا وَسَلَامًا عَلَىٰ إِبْرَاهِيمٍ. We told the fire, O fire, instead of being hot, be a coolness and be a peace and comfort for Ibrahim. And so he was thrown into this fire, and the people thought that he would die, but instead he was saved from the fire. And this miracle proved to us, as it proved to his people, that this is what happens when you put your trust in Allah. When you put your trust in Allah, Allah says in the Quran, وَمَنْ يَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ فَهُوَ حَسْبُهُ. If you truly rely in Allah, Allah will be sufficient for you. If you truly rely in Allah, and you know that Allah will take care of you, then no matter what society does, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will come forth, and He will protect you, and He will give you what you need. When His people saw this miracle, they still rejected, and they told Him He cannot live anymore amongst them. And so, He became the first human being ever to immigrate from one land to another for the sake of religious freedom and religious persecution. He was not allowed to worship in his community. And so he became the first muhajir, the first person to ever do hijrah, showing us that the most important matter in this life is the freedom to worship Allah. And if we don't have that freedom, then we need to fight for that freedom. And if we don't have that freedom, then we go somewhere else where we are free to establish that worship of Allah. He chose Allah over his people. He chose the worship of Allah over his society. And he said, if you're going to reject me, so be it. And he said to his father, Salamun alayka sa'astaghfiru laka rabbi. May peace be unto you, my father. I will continue to ask Allah to guide and forgive you. And he went on his way. And he married his wife Sarah. And they made their way through Egypt, another tyrannical land at the time. And the leaders of Egypt tried to seduce his wife. They captured Sarah. And the king of Egypt, because she was a beautiful lady, he tried to do with her like any evil tyrant does. And she put her trust in Allah. And Ibrahim at that time was making dua to Allah in his tent. Oh Allah, protect my wife. So far away from the palace, but again he put his trust in Allah. And so this tyrannical king was paralyzed, and he was not able to raise a finger, to lift a finger to harm Sarah. Once again showing that when you put your trust in Allah, you can have an army facing you, you can have the mightiest king of Egypt, but if Allah is on your side, then nothing can harm you. And so he gives them Hajar, Hagar, and Hajar becomes yet another convert to this new religion. There were only three people who worshipped Allah at the time. Ibrahim, Sarah and Hajar. And they go and they migrate to a land so that they can worship Allah. And Ibrahim alayhi salam is told when he's at the age of 80 Allah reveals a whole set of laws, a whole sharia. And Ibrahim is told in this set of laws, he is given the Abrahamic covenant that all true followers of Abraham are told to fulfill. He is told to circumcise. He is the only believer. There is no other believer that can circumcise him. And so at the age of 80, our Prophet Muhammad ﷺ tells us, as an 80-year-old man, when the laws come down, he circumcises himself. And this shows us, as every man here can understand, how difficult this is. At one part, we are aghast. Another part of us finds this amazing. But think about it. As an 80-year-old man, when Allah reveals a whole set of laws, what we call the sharia for his time, and a part of those laws, and this is of course the covenant that Abraham took with all of his children, that to this day, Jews and Muslims and the true followers of Jesus Christ, of course this, as you know, Paul abrogated these laws, but Jesus Christ himself was circumcised and his real followers were circumcised. Paul came and then of course abrogated the laws and says we don't have to circumcise. But the real followers of Jesus Christ continued to follow that, as did Jesus Christ himself. And therefore, Ibrahim became a role model in what it means, in what it means to obey the commandments of Allah, even at great personal hardship and harm. We complain about praying 5 times a day. We complain about giving our zakat in charity. We complain about these laws that are so easy compared to what Ibrahim was told to do. The first human to ever circumcise himself was Ibrahim. And he did it by himself. And he did it at the age of 80. As an old man, he prays to Allah. Oh Allah, I need progeny. I need other children. I need converts. So Allah blesses him first and foremost, before even a child. Allah blesses him with a convert nephew by the name of Lot, Lut. Lut converts to his faith. And Lut is then sent to the evil towns of Sodom and Gomorrah. And you know the stories in the Bible and the Quran. And the angels come to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. On the way there, they pass by Ibrahim alayhi salam to give him the good news that he's going to have a child. And they tell Ibrahim that your prayer to have a child has been answered, and we are angels sent to the people of Sodom and Gomorrah because of their sinful ways. And Ibrahim, because of his gentleness, because of his mercy, he begins to plead on behalf of the people of Sodom and Gomorrah. And this is a fact that the Old Testament does not mention. It's only in the Quran. Because he's so full of mercy, he begins to argue with the angels. Spare them. Give them some more time. They might repent. Even though Allah had decreed punishment upon them, Ibrahim's heart was so merciful, so tender. That's exactly what Allah says in the Quran. إِنَّهُ كَانَ أَوَّاهًا. He was a person who was a tender-hearted man. And he wanted to plead with in front of Allah to forgive or to let this punishment pass by. But Ibrahim was told, in the Quran we are told, Ibrahim is told, O Ibrahim, once our commandment has come, we don't take it back. Allah doesn't play games. Once the commandment has been issued, it is not going to be taken back. There's no point arguing. But look here, we are told to take Ibrahim as a role model, correct? What did we learn from this? That the tenderness that he had, even though Allah has decreed they are going to be punished, still his heart was tender. Compare this to some Muslims. How they view evil people, how they view sinners. Nothing but hardship and sarcasm, nothing but arrogance. Oh, look at these people, they're this, they're that. Is this what we learn from Ibrahim? The very people whom Allah is going to destroy, he feels pity for them. He feels love for them. He feels compassion for them. And this is what we learn from Ibrahim alayhi salam. He is told he's going to have a son. And so after such a long time, he has a son. And of course his firstborn is Ishmael. And Ismail is born to Hajar. And he is happy and rejoiced. Yet Sarah becomes jealous because Sarah does not have children. And Sarah wants Hajar and Ismail to leave, to get out. And so Ibrahim is told by Allah, very well, go and abandon, leave them in the abandoned desert. In the valleys of Bekka, the Old Testament calls it Paran. In the valleys of Bekka, go abandon them and put your trust in me. I'll take care of them. And so he takes his servant, his maidservant Hajar, his concubine, his wife in a way, a woman whom he's loved and he has born children with, and he takes the newborn Ismail, barely a year old, and he leaves them in Mecca with no water and food, because that is what Allah has told him to do. And he turns his back and begins walking away. And Hajar calls out, "O Ibrahim, where are you going? O Ibrahim, where have you left us? There is nobody here, there's no food, there's no water." And Ibrahim, can you imagine, every father amongst us, he hears his son crying. He hears his wife begging and pleading. He has been told by his Lord to leave them. And he cannot say anything. What is he supposed to do? He continues walking, and Hajar understands that this tender man, this loving father, this husband would never do this unless his Lord has told him. And so Hajar asks him, "O Ibrahim, has Allah told you to do this?" And now he can respond and he says, "Yes, He has told me." So Hajar, because she has been with Ibrahim, even though she was an Egyptian pagan before, even though she was an idol worshipper, but she has now associated with Ibrahim. She has seen a true prophet of God. And so when she converts, she doesn't just convert to the faith. She becomes one of the most powerful Muslims ever. And so when she hears that Allah has told Ibrahim to leave them alone, she goes back to take care of Ismail and says, "In that case, Allah will take care of us. I put my trust in Allah." That tawakkul, that trust, she has learnt it from Ibrahim, and she's going to apply it in her life as well. So they stay there for a few hours. After a while, the water that she has, the bottle of water finishes up. What is she going to do? She knows Allah will take care of them, but how? So she goes to the mountain of Marwa, the mountain of Safa, the mountain of Marwa. She goes back and forth 7 times. And these very days, the pilgrims, 3 million of them, will commemorate that walk that she gave between Safa and Marwa, back and forth, back and forth, putting her trust in Allah. "I know that Allah will take care of us. I know that my child will not die." But she's panicking because she's a mother. She's looking at the mountain. Where is the caravan that's going to come? Because she thinks Allah is going to cause somebody to bring water. She doesn't realize that the water will sprout forth from under her feet. She thinks Allah is going to cause a caravan to go. So she's looking in the distance. Safa, Marwa, Safa, Marwa. 7 times she goes. She finds nothing. The child is crying. The child is starving, is dehydrating in the desert. She runs back to give him shelter. And there Jibreel comes, the angel Gabriel. And with one touch of his wing and the commandment of Allah, the well of Zamzam sprouts forth. The well of Zamzam from the very feet of Ismail. From the very feet where Ismail is kicking, from there the well of Zamzam comes forth. That well, that to this day it is a miraculous well, let us make no qualms about this. In the middle of the desert, to this day we cannot explain how so much water is coming for the city of Mecca, how millions of pilgrims throughout the year come and the water never finishes. The water never finishes. It is an unceasing well of water that has lasted for the last 4,000 years in the city of Mecca. To this day, Hujjaj are going to come and they're going to bring water back from Zamzam. How many hundreds of millions of liters come forth in the middle of the desert? Where does it come from? Allah has blessed Ibrahim and Ismail to take care of Ismail. This well has lasted until the day of judgment. And it will last until the day of judgment. Once again, this is what happens when you have true faith in Allah. From the middle of the desert, Allah will take care of you. And then Ibrahim is told to go visit Ismail. But it's not just a normal visit, because Allah tells him that this son of yours, whom you love so much, at that time he doesn't have Isaac, he doesn't have Ishaq, he only has Ishmael. And he is told in the Quran that you love your son, but Allah has told you to sacrifice your son for Allah. Allah has told you that to get rid of this son. Allah wants you to now eliminate him. And not just, Allah is not just going to take him a regular death. It's not just going to be a disease. It's not going to be an accident. You, by your own hands, have to lie him down in the sand and raise up a knife and sacrifice, a human sacrifice. Even though our religion doesn't allow this, but Allah tested Ibrahim. Ibrahim didn't know it's a test, right? Ibrahim didn't know it's a test. And so he is told, with your own hands, get rid of this object of love, because only I am worthy of devotion. It was a test to see who he loved more, Allah or his son. Can you imagine at the age of 95, at the age of 95, one son he has. He thinks he's about to die in a few years. He has no progeny left. The amount of love he must have for this child. And now he is told, I have to sacrifice you. And so he obeys the commandment of Allah Azza wa Jal. And he takes the teenager Ismail. We are told in the Quran, Ismail said to his father, "Do as you have been told. I too believe in Allah." Can you imagine a 13-year-old with such iman and faith? And so he lays him down and he raises the axe, he raises the sword, and he hesitates. And of course, Shaitan appears in front of him. And Shaitan says, "Have you gone crazy? Have you gone mad? He is your only son. What are you doing? How can you kill him?" And Ibrahim knows this is Satan. This is Shaitan the accursed. And so he pelts him with 7 stones. And at that very point, to this day, millions of pilgrims are pelting the Jamrat al-Kubra. And Shaitan goes away. So Ibrahim doesn't want to remain in the same place, so he goes to another place to make sure Shaitan doesn't come back. Once again, Shaitan comes back. Once again, he pelts him with 7 stones. And once again, he takes him to another place. And those 3 places, Jamrat al-Kubra, Jamrat al-Sughra, Jamrat al-Wusta, to this day, the very point that Ibrahim alayhi salam tried to sacrifice his son, we commemorate it. The pilgrims commemorate it. They will commemorate it 3 days in a row. On the 10th and the 11th and the 12th, some of them even the 13th, they're going to stone these pillars as a symbol that Shaitan will never cause me to come between me and the commandments of Allah. I will obey the commandments of Allah regardless of whatever. And so when he displayed this determination, and he raised up the axe, as Allah says in the Quran, فَلَمَّا أَسْلَمَ وَتَلَّهُ لِلْجَبِينَ, when he laid his son on the sacrificial stone, and the knife is up in the air, and he is now about to lower this and kill his own son, Allah knows there is sincerity. That is when the commandment comes down. Stop! You have fulfilled what Allah told you to do. قَدْ صَدَّقْتَ الرُّؤْيَا. Allah doesn't want human sacrifice from us, but Allah wanted to test Ibrahim. And Ibrahim won with flying colors. "Here is a lamb, O Ibrahim. Sacrifice this ram instead of your son." And so to this day, every one of us on Saturday or Sunday or Monday, every one of us, either we've sent money somewhere or we ourselves are going to go and sacrifice a sheep or a goat or a lamb or a cow or a camel. All around the world, millions of animals will be sacrificed commemorating the spirit of Ibrahim alayhi salam, commemorating the sincerity of Ibrahim, commemorating the passion of Ibrahim alayhi salam. His son grows older and Allah tells him, "You are going to build the first house of worship, the first mosque, the first church, the first synagogue. There has never been a house of worship on this earth before. You, O Ibrahim, are going to build the first house of worship." And to this day, that house is venerated by billions of people around the world. They face it when they pray. To this day, every single year, hundreds of millions of pilgrims perform the Umrah and the Hajj. Right now, as we speak, 2-3 million people are doing tawaf, and they will do tawaf tomorrow and the day after tomorrow and the next few days. And they will do hundreds of millions of tawafs because they're doing multiple tawafs. Non-stop from the time of Ibrahim up until the day of judgment, to commemorate that spirit of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And Ibrahim alayhi salam is blessed with another son to show him gratitude, to give him thanks. And that son is Isaac and Ishaq. And Allah says that from the both of them shall be great nations. From the both of them shall be great nations. And so from Ishaq come forth all of the prophets of Israel and the children of Israel. From Ishaq come forth David and Solomon. From Ishaq come forth Jesus Christ. From Ishaq come forth all of the prophets of the Old Testament. And the Jews are the descendants of Ishaq. And from Ismail comes forth the Arab race. And from Ismail comes forth the final and the seal of all prophets. And that is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Ibrahim was so righteous and pious that every single prophet that came after him was from his progeny. From his 2 sons, Ismail and Ishaq. No other prophet came except that he was from the children of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And this shows us what happens when you dedicate your life to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says in the Quran, وَإِذْ ابْتَلَى إِبْرَاهِيمَ رَبُّهُ بِكَلِمَاتٍ فَأَتَمَّهُنْ. Remember when Allah tested Ibrahim with a series of commandments and he fulfilled all of them. He fulfilled all of those commandments. And when he did so, Allah says, قَالَ إِنِّي جَاعِلُكَ لِلنَّاسِ إِمَامًا. I shall make you a leader amongst men. And how true is that? The greatest venerated human being, The most number of people in the world who venerate one person, that is the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam. The Jews, the Christians, the Muslims, more than half of humanity. And if you want to add the Hindus because of this misinterpretation of Brahman, which is a valid theory, then in fact almost two-thirds of humanity looks up to this one figure of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And that is exactly what our Prophet Muhammad s.a.w. is told, that you have a great role model to look up to in Ibrahim. And Allah says in the Quran, the closest followers to Ibrahim are this Prophet, the Prophet Muhammad s.a.w. and those who follow him. The closest follower to Ibrahim is the descendant of Ibrahim, and that is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Allah tells us in the Quran, and he tells the Quraysh of Mecca, that this is the religion of your own father, millata abikum Ibrahim. This is the religion of your forefather, Ibrahim alayhi salam. From the story of Ibrahim, we learn patience, we learn perseverance. From the story of Ibrahim, we learn commitment and dedication. From the story of Ibrahim, we learn what it means to stand up and preach the truth, even if everybody else rejects it. From the story of Ibrahim, we learn what it means to be a brave person. From the story of Ibrahim, we learn sincerity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. From the story of Ibrahim, we learn patience and persecution. From the story of Ibrahim, we learn what it means to follow the commandments of Allah, even if that's at great pressure to oneself and to one's family. And from the story of Ibrahim, we learn what happens when you dedicate your life to Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you back more, much more in this world and the next. Indeed, there is a great role model for all of us in Ibrahim alayhi salam and for those who follow him. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-azim wa nafa'ani wa iyyakum bima fihi min al-ayat wa dhikr al-hakim aqulu ma tasma'un wa astaghfirullah al-azim li wa lakum wa li sa'il muslimin min kulli dhanbin fastaghfiruhu innahu huwal ghafur rahim. Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah, Al-Wahid, Al-Ahad, Al-Fard, Al-Samad, Al-Ladhi Lam Yalid, Wa Lam Yulad, Wa Lam Yakun Lahu Kufwan Ahad, Wa Ba'du. Tomorrow is of course the day of Al-Hajj Al-Akbar. Tomorrow is the day of Arafah. Tomorrow is the holiest day of the entire year. And for those who are at the plain of Arafat, then of course our hearts go out to them in happiness and joy and in jealousy, a positive jealousy. We're allowed to be jealous here. We're jealous that they are blessed with this great opportunity to stand on the very plains of Arafat, a plain that we are told Allah Azza wa Jalla himself descends down to, and he boasts to the angels, look at these people gathered in front of me, look at how tired and dusty and disheveled they are, look, they have come to me from all over the world. What do they want? They want my pleasure. O angels, testify that I will give them all that they want and more than this. Indeed, those who are on that plain are blessed and fortunate. And we pray that one day, inshallah, we too can go regularly to this great pilgrimage of Hajj. But for those who are not, for those of us who are here, the day as well is a blessed day. It is a holy day. And our Prophet Muhammad ﷺ said that the one who fasts on this day, the one who fasts on this day, shall have all of his sins of the previous and the next year forgiven. 2 full years of the minor sins, obviously not the major sins. 2 full years. It's a blessed and holy day. And it is authentically narrated that the Tabi'un and the scholars of the past who did not go for Hajj, they would spend their time in the masjid and in the worship of Allah. And they would say, if I cannot be with them in body, at least I'm with them in my spirit. At least I'm doing what they're doing in dua, in dhikr. Therefore, today, tomorrow, and even Eid and the days after Eid, because in one hadith the Prophet ﷺ said the best day of the year is Yawm al-Nahr, which is the 10th of Dhul-Hijjah. And so the 9th and the 10th are competing with one another for which one is the best day, and both have their fadila or excellence each in its own way. So the 9th and the 10th of Dhul-Hijjah, which is what we are currently experiencing tomorrow and the day after tomorrow, these are indeed the most blessed days of the year. So our Prophet ﷺ said, therefore increase in it your remembrance of Allah, your dhikr, your takbir and tahmid and tahleel, to say subhanallah, alhamdulillah, la ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. These are the days of celebration. The celebration for what? For having been guided to the worship of Allah, for having been guided to the religion of Ibrahim alayhi salam. These are the days of rejoice. These are the days of sacrifice. These are the days where we think about Ibrahim alayhi salam and we learn from his life all of these magnificent lessons. For those who are fasting today as well, alhamdulillah, even better, because it is mustahab to fast one day before Saturday if you're going to only fast Saturday. However, it is completely permissible to fast Saturday by itself. And so for those who are not fasting today, make sure that inshaAllah ta'ala we make a concerted effort to fast tomorrow. And of course the fasting on the 10th is not allowed because that is the day of Eid. And so from the day of Eid, the 10th, the 11th and the 12th and even up until the 13th, these are days that we try to do our sacrifices. These are days that we are extra charitable. These are days that we increase our adhkar, we increase our dhikr. After every salah on these days, we raise the takbirat. For 3 days, we raise the takbirat, beginning from the salat al-eid. And then working up until the asr of the third day. We raise our voices and we say, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, walillahi alhamd. We say these takbirat, these tahmidat, these tahleelat. We say them continuously, not just after the salawat, but morning and evening, day and night, because these are the days where we commemorate what Ibrahim alayhi salam did, and that is done by worshipping Allah, by increasing in our reliance upon Him, by remembering him morning and evening, and by worshipping him the way that the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam worshipped him. I conclude this khutbah with a beautiful hadith, a hadith that is relevant to all that I have said. It is reported in Tirmidhi that our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went up to the journey of al-Isra wal-Mi'raj, as the ascension, the miraculous journey. And he came back down and he told us, I met my father Ibrahim. I met my father Ibrahim alayhi salam. And his back was taking a rest on Al-Bayt Al-Ma'mur. Al-Bayt Al-Ma'mur, as many of you know, this is the equivalent of the Kaaba of the angels. The angels have their equivalent of the Kaaba. The angels have a holy structure as well. And they do tawaf around it like we do tawaf around the Kaaba on earth. And they visit it like we visit the Kaaba on earth. And so Ibrahim, it is befitting that he is occupying that Bayt Al-Ma'mur because he built the Kaaba on earth. And I saw him in Bayt Al-Ma'mur. And when he saw me, he said to me, Ya Muhammad, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أقرئ أمتك مني السلام. I want you to give my salams to your ummah. Ibrahim alayhi salam is giving us his greetings through our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I want you to tell them that paradise is a beautiful place and that it's waters are luscious and cold, and that its soil is fertile, but it is barren. A Jannah that is barren? How can that be a Jannah? Our Prophet Ibrahim said to our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and tell them that the seedlings that they need to plant in their gardens in Jannah, the soil is fertile, but you need to plant something in it. The seedlings that you need to plant in order to make those trees are subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar. These are the days of dhikr. These are the days of takbir and tahmid. These are the days of building our paradises in this world and in the next. How do we do that? By remembering Allah, by worshipping Allah, by putting our trust in Allah, by being sincere to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in all of this, we have the role models of the greatest prophets who ever walked on this earth, and in particular, the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam and our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst the true followers of the Prophets of Allah. Allahumma inni da'in fa'aminu. Allahumma la tada' lana fi hadha al-yawmi dhanban illa ghafarta, wa la hamman illa farajta, wa la daynan illa qadayta, wa la maridan illa shafayta, wa la asiran illa yassarta. Allahumma ighfir lana wa li ikhwanina alladhina sabaquna bil iman, wa la taj'al fi qulubina ghillan lil ladhina amanu. Rabbana innaka ra'ufur rahim. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم من أرادنا أو أراد الإسلام والمسلمين بالسوء فأشغله بنفسه واجعل تدميره في تدبيره يا قوي يا عزيز. عباد الله، إن الله تعالى أمركم بأمر بدأ به بنفسه وثنى بملائكة قدسه وثلث بكم أيها المؤمنون من جنه وإنسه، فقال عز من قائل عليما: إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك وأنعم على عبدك ورسولك محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. عباد الله، إن الله تعالى يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. اذكروا الله العظيم يذكركم واشكروه يزد لكم ولذكر الله تعالى أكبر وأقم الصلاة.